Scripture lesson for our sermon today comes from 2 Peter chapter 3, beginning at verse 8. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Indeed, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. So then, dear friends, since you are looking forward to this, make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. Bear in mind that our Lord's patience means salvation, just as our dear brother Paul also wrote you with the wisdom that God gave him. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Hurry up and wait. Very often that is our mantra. At least it's my mantra. We wait for good things like babies to be born, driver's licenses to be attained. We wait for all sorts of good things, but sometimes we have things that we dread. We might have had a biopsy done, and we're having to wait through a long weekend for the results to be shared on a Monday. We may have heard the cacophony of all of our children or grandchildren sitting behind us in the back seat of the car saying for the 1,100th millionth time, are we there yet? Are we there yet? Or perhaps we've been online with some company, IT or tech support or customer support even, and we've heard that innocuous hypnotic music, and every now and then we hear the words that have been recorded, your call is important to us. And we don't feel that importance. Very often we've said about things that are slow in coming. We've said about those things that have been delayed that they are as slow as Christmas. But it's not so slow right now, is it? 2 weeks from today is Christmas Eve. 2 weeks from today. And the question for me and the question for us all from this passage of Scripture, are we ready? Are we ready for Christmas? I propose that there are two attributes that I need to have, perhaps you need to have, but I will admit that I know that I need to have them so that I might be ready for Christmas, so that I might be able to wait patiently. The first is contentment. Contentment and peace go together. Tom and Diane Menard lit the candle of peace. Last week it was the candle of hope, and this week the candle of peace. The candle of peace. We need peace, and contentment equals peace, at least in my mind. Waiting requires faith. Patience is not the ability to wait, but it's the ability to wait with a good attitude. The ability to wait with a good attitude. Sometimes I don't have that good attitude. I find myself, perhaps you've done the same thing, either in the hospital elevator or the elevator of a department store or some elevator somewhere, and you are in a hurry and you keep pushing, mashing, pressing over and over again that closed door button. Unfortunately, I hate to burst your bubble, but since 1990, when the Americans with Disabilities Act was passed, that closed door button doesn't work anymore. It's a placebo button because it needs to take its time for those with walkers or those with canes or those in wheelchairs and those in other situations to be able to get in the car. But we mash, we push, we press. And pretty much that's what we do. Rather than contentment and peace, we have anxiety, and we don't like waiting. We don't like waiting. I read of an airline carrier that was having difficulty. They were getting complaints over and over again from people who were saying that they were incensed about having to wait for their luggage to come into the baggage carousel at the baggage claim area of the airport. And so they hired more people to get the baggage from the gate to the baggage claim area all the quicker. But the complaints didn't go down. People got off the plane, and they made it to the baggage claim area in 1 minute, and they had to wait for 8 minutes for their baggage to get there. 88% said that the new procedures and all the people hired had done no good. 88% were still dissatisfied. And guess what the airliner did? They decided to move all of the gates for the arriving planes and their luggage furthest from the terminal and the baggage claim area. And the people got off the plane and they walked 8 minutes to the baggage claim. And by the time they got there, they only had to wait for a minute for their baggage to arrive. Still the same amount of time. But instead of waiting for 1 minute in exchange for 8 minutes, people with no complaints waited shortly for their baggage to come. Why did they not complain? Because we hate to wait. Contentment. The Apostle Paul says, I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I have learned the secret of being content. That secret of contentment was by putting his trust in God. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, is the following verse after these words about contentment in Philippians chapter 4. Contentment. Trusting in the Lord, the Prince of Peace. It tells us in Isaiah chapter 9 that unto us a son is given, and his name shall be Everlasting Father. His name shall be even Prince of Peace. And of his government and of his peace there shall be no end. And yet we are not a people of peace. We frantically go through life. And out of 3,550 years of recorded history, there have only been 286 years that have been without war. We are a people not at peace. Not at peace. We've been through the fire, literally. Peter says that the next end of the world will not come through water, but with fire. And all the elements will be laid bare. We have been through the fire, some of us already. And we smell of the smoke of that fire, of all the difficulties and losses we have endured. But what we need to hear this day is that we can find contentment through the Prince of Peace because Jesus is with us. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church's last words were, best of all, God is with us. In Isaiah chapter 7, it says that the virgin shall be with child, and she shall give birth to a son, and his name shall be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. Jesus is with us through the flames of the fire. All you need to look at is Isaiah chapter 43, where Jesus is prophesied about that when we go through the flood waters, God will be with us. When we go through the fire, the flames will not overtake us because God is with us. When we read about Daniel and those three Israelites in the lion's den with Nebuchadnezzar looking on in Daniel chapter 4, verse 32, we see there, just as Nebuchadnezzar did, that they were not three Israelites in the fiery furnace, but there was a fourth who was not consumed by the flames. Jesus. So God is with us. Emmanuel has come, and because of that contentment we can have through Christ, we can have true peace. First Peter is all about the problems we go through from external sources, and Second Peter is written for the problems that we ourselves face internally, the conflicts we ourselves have. The second thing that I need besides contentment is confidence. Confidence in God. confidence that leads to true patience. Ambrose Bierce, wonderful author, said this about patience as he gave a definition of patience. Patience, a noun, a minor form of despair disguised as a virtue. Feels that way sometimes. Oh, Lord, I need patience, but I want it right now, we pray. But confidence is the ability to wait patiently. Peace that is active. If you want real peace, you need to be a peacemaker. If you want real faith, you need to practice faith and have confidence in God. The confidence that God wants to bring peace to this world. You remember Bret Hart's short story, The Luck of Roaring Camp, about a camp of miners that indeed was a roaring place, a rip-roaring place. There was only one woman there, Cherokee Sal, and she had a baby. No one knew who the father was, but Cherokee Sal had a baby and died in childbirth, and they gave the child the name Tommy and gave him the last name Luck, since they didn't know of another name, that perhaps he would bring luck to them. And he did more than that. He didn't bring luck as in finding gold, but they found themselves and they found peace because the luck of Roaring Camp turned that roaring camp of nasty miners and all of their vices, turned them into caregiving dads and adopted fathers for this precious little baby. The luck of Roaring Camp is who Jesus is for all of us. Jesus wants to bring peace to this roaring world in which we live and bring change to us so that we find better, better lives. But will we have the confidence to let God be God? Will we have confidence to let the Prince of Peace calm down this roaring camp of ours? There was a man who was talking to a friend of his about the success of his marriage. And he explained it this way. He said, when my wife and I got married on our honeymoon, I told her that I would be in charge of all the big decisions and she would be in charge of all the small decisions. And his friend said, well, how's it going for you? He said, well, we've been married for 30 years. We had 3 children. We bought, sold, or built 3 homes. And we bought at least 15 cars, and I'm still waiting on a big decision that I get to make. A lot of truth in that. But even more truth in that is, will we allow God to make the big decisions about our lives? Not just the big decisions, but the small decisions as well. Will we turn our lives over to God? Will we have confidence that God is able to handle all that we give Him? Isaiah 26:3 says, He will keep in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. I want that perfect peace. I love Psalm 46:10. Be still and know that I am God. Be at peace. Be at peace. Jesus is coming even when we believe and feel that He's not, such as the people in 2 Peter. They thought that He wasn't coming. He had been a long time. That 1,000 years is to the Lord is like a day, and a day is like 1,000 years. But when God seems most absent, we believe in confidence that God is most present with us. Think about it this way. There are 39 books in the Old Testament. There are 4 different groupings of those 39 books. The first 5 books of the Old Testament are the Torah, the Pentateuch, the books of law. And then there are 12 books of history. And after those 12 books of history, there are 6 books of poetry in the Old Testament. And there are 16 books that follow, 16 books of prophecy. But in all 4 groupings of the Old Testament books, there is mention of Jesus coming again, of the Messiah, of God's Holy One coming to judge the world. There is more evidence in the Old Testament about God's second coming than about His first, even though both are there. And then the New Testament. There are 27 books in the New Testament. There are 3 groupings. Of course, you have first the 4 Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And then you have 1 history book, the book of Acts. And then after that, there are 22 different letters written to different people and places by different authors, 22 epistles. But all 3 of those groupings of the New Testament books talk about Jesus' second coming. There are a lot of wonderful teachings in the Bible. For instance, I would imagine all of us would agree that the new birth, being born again, regeneration, is a key teaching, but it is only mentioned in the New Testament 9 times. Baptism, I would assume that you would believe along with me that baptism is of huge importance, but baptism is only mentioned 20 times. Repentance is another key teaching. Repentance, it's only mentioned 70 times. But Jesus' second coming, can you imagine? It's mentioned 380 times. One out of every 25 verses in the New Testament is about Jesus' coming again. So what is our confidence in? Over and over again, we have been taught Jesus is coming again to make this world a better place, to set things right, to conquer injustice, to conquer death and sadness and pain. Jesus is coming. That is our hope. That is our confidence. So if I want to be ready for Christmas, ready or not, it's coming. If I want to hurry up and wait so that I can wait for it to come in a way that really makes a difference. If I want true peace, I need to have contentment. And I need to have confidence. Contentment that comes from God and confidence in God. And so should we all. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we do pray that you might allow us to wait patiently, to know that you are coming, that you're patient with us, and that's why you've been delayed. You want every one of us to be prepared in our hearts. So quietly, gently, oh Lord, we pray, may your Holy Spirit shine through our shadows and give us hope. Oh Lord, fill us even in spite of our circumstances. Fill us with hope that comes from contentment and confidence. For you are God who keeps his word. Through Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen.